5 seconds to go. Start. The intention of the respondent was not honest, as he found that the respondent was trying to sell the property in dispute to some other party at a much higher price. Having found that the respondent was not interested to execute the sale deed as agreed upon, he approached the respondent on 21st of June 2006 to execute the sale deed, when he also intimated the respondent that he was ready and willing to perform his part of the contract to execute the sale deed. The respondent refused to perform its part of the contract and informed that they would not execute the sale deed until and unless the appellant agreed to pay a higher sale consideration over and above what was agreed to between the parties. Having found that the respondent was trying to sell the property in dispute to a third party at a higher price, the appellant filed an application under Section 9 of the Act on 23rd of June 2006 before the City Civil Judge, Bangalore, for injunction restraining the respondent from alienating, altering, or creating any third party interest in respect of the property in dispute. With the application, the appellant also filed an application under Order 39, Rule 1 and 2, read with Section 151 CPC, for temporary injunction restraining the respondent from transferring, alienating, or creating any third party interest in the same. The respondent entered appearance and denied the material allegations made in the application for injunction. It was the specific case of the respondent that, since time was the essence of the contract and the appellant having failed to perform his part of the obligation of the contract, the respondent was not bound to execute the sale deed, and therefore the agreement for sale was cancelled by the respondent. The additional City Civil Judge, Bangalore, by his order dated 23rd of September 2006, allowed the application filed by the appellant inter alia on a finding that there are serious issues to be tried before the arbitrator and that the appellant has successfully made out a prima facie case for grant of injunction in the manner prayed for in the application. The learned additional City Civil Judge, Bangalore, while disposing of the application for injunction, came to a finding prima facie that the respondent intended to sell the property in dispute to some other persons at a higher price, as it was found that the intending purchasers were frequently visiting for the purpose of purchasing the property in dispute. The additional City Civil Judge, Bangalore, therefore held prima facie that the respondent was likely to sell the property in dispute, and if it was sold, it would make the award of the learned arbitrator infructuous, for which the appellant shall suffer irreparable loss and injury. Accordingly, upon the aforesaid findings, the additional City Civil Judge, Bangalore, disposed of the application for injunction, directing the parties to maintain status quo in the matter of transferring, alienating and creating any third party interest in respect of the property in dispute. On an examination of the pleadings of two writ petitions, we find that the issues for consideration were all different in the petitions. In the first petition, relief was sought under the Contract Labour Act 1970 for abolition of contract labour system in the operation of canteen in the marketing establishment of IOC and for absorbing the canteen workers as employees of IOC. In the second petition, relief was sought under the Industrial Disputes Act 1947 for making a reference under Section 10(1) to the Industrial Tribunal to decide whether the contract between IOC and the canteen contractor was sham, nominal, and a mere camouflage to avoid extension of labor law benefits to the workers in question, and whether the canteen workers were the direct employees of IOC. The assumption that the appellant had taken inconsistent stands in the two writ petitions is not correct. Even in the first writ petition, the appellant had contended that though the contractors changed from time to time, the workers in the canteen remained the same with continuity of service, that IOC had mollified and illegally kept the workers as contract labor in order to keep them in a permanent state of insecurity and to deny them the wages and privileges available to permanent workers that IOC was actually controlling and supervising the canteen, and that only as a camouflage the contractor was shown as running the canteen to create a pretense that the workmen of IOC were the workers of the contractor, when in fact they were the employees of IOC. In short, the appellant had contended that the contract was sham and nominal in the first petition. Even in the second writ petition, the contention was that the contract was sham and a camouflage to avoid extending benefits of regular employees to the canteen workers. Therefore, the High Court committed a serious error in assuming that in the first writ petition, the appellant had conceded that the contract between the IOC and the canteen contractor was valid and genuine, and that in the second writ petition, the appellant had taken a contrary stand that the contract was sham and a camouflage. The stand of the appellant and the workers was always consistent. But before the decision of a constitution bench of this court in Steel Authority of India Limited versus National Union Waterfront Workers 2001-7 SCC 1, it was thought that the appropriate relief available was to seek an investigation and abolition of contract labor and consequently seek absorption. Therefore, the prayer was made in the first petition. This court held that even if there was an order under Section 10 of the Act prohibiting contract labor in any process or operation, there would be no automatic absorption of the contract labor by the principal employer. It was also held that it is always open to the contract labor to urge that the contract was sham and nominal by raising an industrial dispute, and such dispute will have to be decided by the industrial adjudicator and not by the High Court. Stop. Dear friends, a word was used in between the dictation, that is camouflage. I pronounced it wrongly. Actually, it is CAMOUFLAGE. That is camouflage. But I pronounced it camouflage. So the exact pronunciation is camouflage. Thank you.